are you holding on to this morning, church?
I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. He is faithful. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes behind.
I know who stands behind.
I know who stands behind.
The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Somebody say the one who reigns. Forever.
He is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Y'all can have a seat. Rest a little.
I came up out of the water. I raised my hands up to the Father. I gave it all to him that day. I felt a new wind kiss my face. I walked away with eyes wide open. Finally see where I was going. It didn't matter where I'd been. I'm not the same way I was then. I cut off track, I made mistakes. I backslid my way into that place where souls get lost, lines get crossed, and the pain won't go away. I've hit my knees, now here I stand. Here I was, now here I am. Here I am, changed. I got a lot of hey, I'm sorry. The things I've done, man, that was not. I wish that I could take it all back. I just wanna tell them that. Tell them that I got off track. I made mistakes. Backslid my way into that place where souls get lost, lines get crossed, and the pain won't go away. I hit my knees, now here I stay. There I was, now here I am.
For one, stand before you this morning grateful that the Lord changed this rebel heart. Amen. Amen. Thank you, praise team. Just an awesome time of worship here this morning. I told it was good to see Stephen behind that guitar, but I told him earlier that Bailey looked a lot better behind it. but wow, just the talent we've got. We're going to go ahead and let the kids make their way to the back. If they'll just go through this side door, I think we've got something all the way up to age or to grade six. Grade six. We'll let Stephen go ahead and finish cleaning up his mess. And I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles and open them with me to the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 47. This morning we're going to be looking at verses 1 to 12. Ezekiel's found in the Old Testament. If you find the book of Jeremiah, it'll be followed by the book of Lamentations, and then the book of Ezekiel. Now, if you were with us in our verse-by-verse study of 2 Peter, you will remember that we looked at what the Bible calls the Day of the Lord. And we dedicated an entire lesson, an entire Sunday morning, to all the events that will take place during that specific period of time. And we saw that the Day of the Lord begins with the return of Christ. And the Bible says that He will come like a thief in the night. Jesus will come suddenly and unexpectedly and remove His church from the world. And once the church is removed from the world, the seven-year tribulation will begin. It'll be a time of great sorrow as God pours out His wrath and judgment upon the world. And this period culminates with the Battle of Armageddon, when Jesus will make war with the nations. And after the dust settles, the Bible says Jesus will stand victorious, the nation of Israel will be saved, and Satan and his demons will be cast into the bottomless pit. And once that takes place, the millennial kingdom is ushered in. This is where Christ will reign on earth for 1,000 years from his throne in Israel. It'll be a glorious time, a time when God will restore all things the way they were originally intended to be. There will be a new heaven and a new earth, a time where all things will be made new. And being that we're having a baptism a little later today, there's one aspect of this new heaven and new earth, this millennial kingdom, that I would have us to turn our attention to here this morning, and that is the water, specifically the river of life. And we're given a description of that river that every believer will one day see and enjoy here in the book of Ezekiel. Now, what we have recorded here in the 47th chapter is a portion of a vision that Ezekiel has received from the Lord. And this vision actually begins way back in chapter 40, where we're introduced to this angel who gives Ezekiel a tour of God's new creation. And this angel begins his tour by showing Ezekiel this new temple that God will ultimately dwell in Jerusalem. And in chapters 40 to 43, we're given the exact measurements of everything this temple will entail. And it looks very similar to the schematic that you're going to see here on screen. Now, to begin with, and I hope you guys in the back can see, notice that the temple itself is elevated from the land around it. It is enclosed by a wall, an outer wall, with three gates. And steps lead up to the main complex through those gates. That's how you access the main complex. On the inside, there's a series of chambers that line the perimeter of the wall. And at each corner, the Bible tells us there is a kitchen. There's an outer courtyard to the complex, which consists of two different types of pavement. And then at the center, there's a raised inner courtyard that can be accessed through another series of steps through three more gateways that bring you to that position. And at the center of this inner courtyard is an altar. And behind the altar is the temple proper, where we find the Holy of Holies, the presence of God. And flowing from that dwelling place, you can see that little blue line, is a stream of water, the river of life. And here in chapter 47, Ezekiel brings us down this river. And he begins at the doorway of the temple, between the altar and the temple door itself. And this is what we're told in Ezekiel chapter 47, beginning in verse 1. Ezekiel says, "Afterwards, the angel brought me again unto the door of the house. And behold, waters issued out from under the threshold of the house eastward. For the forefront of the house stood towards the east. And the waters came down from under the right side of the house at the south side of the altar. Then the angel brought me out of the way to the gate northward. and led me about the way without unto the utter gate by the way that looked eastward. And behold, there ran out waters on the right side. And when the angel that had the line in his hand went forth eastward, he measured 1,000 cubits and brought me through the waters, and the waters were to the ankles. Again he measured 1,000 and brought me through the waters were to the knees. Again he measured 1,000 and brought me through, the waters were to the loins, to the waist. Afterwards he measured 1,000 more, and it was a river that I could not pass over, for the waters were risen, waters to swim in, a river that could not be passed over. And the angel said unto me, Son of man, have you seen this? Then he brought me and caused me to return to the bank of the river. Now when I returned, behold, at the bank of the river were many trees on the one side and on the other. Then said he unto me, These waters issue out towards the east country, and go down into the desert, and go into the sea, which being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed. And it shall come to pass that everything that liveth, which moveth, whatsoever the river shall come, shall live. And there shall be a very great multitude of fish, because these waters shall come thither. For they shall be healed, and everything shall live where the river comes. And it shall come to pass that fishermen shall stand upon it from Egadi even unto Inglam. They shall be a place to spread forth nets. Their fish shall be according to their kinds, as the fish of the great sea, exceedingly many. But the miry places thereof and the marshes thereof shall not be healed. They shall be given to salt. And by the river upon the bank thereof, on this side and on that side, shall grow all trees for fruit, whose leaves shall not fade, neither shall the fruit thereof be consumed. It shall bring forth new fruit according to his months, because their waters they issued out of the sanctuary, and the fruit thereof shall be for meat, and the leaf thereof for healing. Let us pray. Father God, we come to you today, Lord, and we just thank you, Lord, for our time of worship, Lord, and we just pray that in this place this morning you will reign supreme. Lord, that your presence will be felt across the board. And Lord, that you will just open our minds and our hearts to what awaits us as believers. And Father God, I pray that you would just generate excitement and anticipation for the day that's coming. And Father God, give us a heavenly perspective. Let us get a glimpse of what Ezekiel saw here this morning. Lord, we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Now today I want to take you on the same tour that the angel took the great prophet Ezekiel. And I want you to see the river of life from four different vantage points. And from each of these vantage points, I want you to see something incredible when it comes to the river of life. And we're going to begin this morning at the doorway to the temple. So let's once again look at our schematic on the screen. Imagine yourself one day standing between the altar and the inner court, facing the temple doorway, facing the house of God. And listen to what Ezekiel says in verse 1. He says, Then the angel brought me to the door of the temple. He's standing at the door of the temple. And behold, water was trickling from below the threshold of the temple towards the east, for the temple faced east. The water was flowing down from below the south end of the threshold of the temple, flowing south of the altar. So here we're introduced to a miraculous trickle of water flowing from the south side of the threshold of the temple door. Now it's obvious that this water is coming from within the temple. But where is it originating from? Well, it's originating from the throne of God that's just on the other side of the doorway. Listen to what we're told in Revelation chapter 22, verse 1. John says, And he showed me a pure river of the water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. The throne of God is the springhead to the river of life. But more specifically, the living water is coming from the Lamb of God. It's coming from none other than Jesus Christ. The Bible says Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And if He is the life, then it only stands to reason that He is the source of the river of life. He is the fountain from which the living waters flow. We're told in Psalms 36, verse 9, "For with Thee is the fountain of life. In Thy light shall we see light." So this trickle of water that is meandering from underneath the temple doorway and by the south side of the altar is coming from the throne of God. That is the source of this river. Now from here, I want to take you to a second vantage point. So with our schematic once again on the screen, imagine yourself walking from the altar down the steps to the northern gateway to the top of your screen, crossing the courtyard there and going down another series of steps to the outside of the complex itself. And from there, you make your way around the corner here to the eastern side, the eastern gate. And listen to what we're told. Listen to what we see. Ezekiel says in verse 2, "Then the angel brought me out of the way of the north gate and led me around on the outside to the outer gate that faces towards the east. And behold, the water was trickling out of the south side of the temple complex." So here we're standing on the outside of the temple itself at the eastern gate. And once again, we find this trickle of water cascading out of the perimeter wall. And here I want you to notice the brilliance of the living waters. Again, we're told in Revelation chapter 22, verse 1, "And He showed me a pure river of the water of life, clear as crystal." Here we see that the water is 100% pure. It's clean. It's free from anything that defiles. There's no debris. There's no mud. There's no trash floating in it. There's nothing that pollutes. Even at a microscopic level, it's absolutely pure. And the Bible says here that this water is clear as crystal. It's totally transparent. Imagine this morning the clearest water you've ever seen, maybe from one of our mountain springs or perhaps those blue ocean waters down off the Keys or in the Caribbean. And as beautiful and as clear as those waters are, eventually that clarity fades into darkness when you reach a certain depth. But not this water. This water is crystal clear. Nothing is impeding its clarity. It's absolutely pure. And that's the case because it's flowing from the One who's absolutely pure. Flowing from the One who knew no sin. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, "For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like we are, yet without sin." That's the reason the water's pure. That's the reason it's crystal clear. It's flowing from the One who's absolutely pure and free from the defilement of sin. So the water's brilliant. There's a splendor to it. Imagine it. It's magnificent. And as the glory of God radiates from His throne, the living waters just shimmer and sparkle there in the distance. And from that vantage point, I want us to take a walk this morning east down the river of life. Listen again to what we're told beginning in verse 3. Ezekiel says, "From there I walked eastward with the angel with the measuring line in his hand. He measured 1,000 cubits and then led me through the water, and it was ankle deep. Again he measured 1,000 cubits more and led me through the water, and it was knee deep. Again he measured 1,000 and led me through the water, and it was waist deep. Again he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not pass through, for the water had risen. It was deep enough to swim in, a river that could not be traversed across. And he said unto me, Son of man, do you see this?" Do you see this church, this morning, church? Imagine it. Put yourself there with Ezekiel and this angel walking down the river of life. Imagine this angel taking a line and measuring 1,000 cubits, 1,800 feet, a third of a mile. And then he turns and crosses the waters. And you're with him. And as you walk, you look down and the waters is ankle deep, splashing up as you make your way to the other bank. And when you reach the other side, the angel walks down the bank and measures out another 1,800 feet, another third of a mile. and you follow him across the stream again, and this time it's knee-deep. And when you get to the bank, the angel takes off again and measures another third of a mile. And he turns and you follow him across the creek. And this time you're wading through the water. You're wading. It's taking you a little bit longer. But eventually you make it to the bank. And then without saying a word, the angel takes off again and measures another 1,800 feet. And when he comes to the end of his line, he turns and you look out and you see that the river is deep enough to swim in. Imagine that this morning, swimming in the river of life. Imagine that. And the angel says, do you see it? Do you see it this morning? There's something supernatural and miraculous taking place here. In just over a mile, this trickle of water from the throne of God has now turned into a river. Now that's impossible in our world. It's impossible. See, in order for that to take place in the universe as we know it, other creeks and other branches would have to contribute to the flow. Other tributaries would have to add their water to this trickle in order for it to become a river. But not in God's kingdom, because here nothing needs to be added to the water. Nothing needs to be added to God's grace. God's grace is sufficient. Maybe you've lived a life close to God this morning and just gotten a little bit dirty. Then all you need to do is cross the river of life in ankle-deep water. Just get cleaned up. Maybe you've lived a little further away from God this morning and gotten a little filthier. Then all you need to do is wade through the waters in waist-deep waters. Or maybe this morning you're a wicked sinner like me and you need to take a swim. A swim in the river of life. And that's where you'll find me one day. You won't find me in the ankle-deep water, the knee-deep water, the waist-deep water. No, you'll find me down at the rock, at the swimming hole, swimming in the river of life. That's where I'll be, swimming in God's amazing grace. Whoever you are this morning, His grace is sufficient. His grace is sufficient. Where sin runs deep, grace is more. You're covered by God's grace. In this new heaven and new earth, you will not be able to outrun God's grace. Imagine that. You won't be able to outrun it. His grace will just get deeper and deeper and deeper the further away you get from His throne, to the point that the waters become unpassable. Do you see it this morning? Do you see the depth of the living waters? Doesn't matter who you are or what you've done, you're covered by God's grace this morning if you're a believer and have put your faith in Jesus Christ. But there's one last vantage point you need to view the river of life from this morning, and that's from the bank. We've walked from the doorway of the temple to the outside of the complex, and now we find ourselves more than a mile downstream in the river of life. And here it's time to take a seat on the bank of the river. And as you sit there on the bank of the river, you need to take it all in. Take it all in and notice the effect that the living waters have on everything it touches. First, notice the transforming effect that the river of life has. Ezekiel says, beginning there at the midpoint of verse 6, "Then the angel led me to the bank of the river. And as I sat back, I saw on the bank of the river many trees on the one side and on the other. And the angel said, 'These waters go out towards the eastern region and go down into Araba. Then they go towards the sea, being made to flow into the sea, and the waters of the sea become fresh.'" The waters become fresh. Now this sea that the river of life ultimately flows in, it's none other than the Dead Sea that we know today. It's flowing into the Dead Sea. Now, as most of you know this morning, nothing can live in the Dead Sea. That's why it's called the Dead Sea. So you've learned something this morning. The water there is 6 times as salty as it is in the ocean. Nothing can survive there. Nothing. Except for maybe some microscopic organisms. But when Christ returns to set up his kingdom, the living water will flow from his throne, and the moment it reaches the Dead Sea, that salt water immediately becomes fresh, is what the Bible says. Immediately becomes fresh. Everything the living waters touch becomes new. Everything it touches is given new life. It's completely transformed. That's what happens when the living waters touch anything. And that's the exact same thing that happens when you're touched by the hand of Jesus Christ. When you're truly touched by Christ, you're changed. You're changed, like we sung about this morning. You're transformed in a supernatural way. That's what I always look for out of someone who claims the name of Christ. Have they been changed? Have they been transformed into something new, something completely different? Do they live a completely different lifestyle? Do they have a completely different take on sin, a completely different outlook on the Bible? There's a newness about them. There's a newness about them. If you've truly been touched by Christ and the living waters, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. That's what happens when you're touched by Christ. And that's what happens in the millennial kingdom when the living waters touch those things that it comes into contact with. Imagine the scene. Imagine the scene. Imagine this scene as the living waters spread throughout the land, transforming everything it touches. Everything it touches. As the living waters flow in the millennial kingdom, the world is transformed into what we read about in Genesis before the fall. That's what's taking place here. Paradise is restored in the millennial kingdom. Secondly, notice the life-giving effect of the living waters. We're told in verse 9 that it will come about that every creature, which swarms in every place where the river goes, will live. And there will be many fish, for these waters that go there and the others become fresh, so that everything will live where the river goes. The river has a life-giving effect. Everything that it touches is given life. And this life is no ordinary life. It's eternal life. And that's the case because our God is eternal this morning. And from his throne comes this continual flow of everlasting life. The river never runs dry. It flows for all of eternity. In John chapter 4, beginning in verse 13, Jesus tells the woman at the well, whosoever drinks of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. From the fountain of life flows the rivers of life, so that we may experience eternal life. Thirdly, notice that the river of life brings joy. It brings joy. And I think this joy can be seen in the fishermen found there in verse 10. Look at what we're told. We're told, and it will come about that fishermen will stand beside it. From Indigai to Inglam, there will be a place for the spreading of nets. Their fish will be according to their kinds, like the fish of the great sea, very many. Notice here that on the banks of the river, there's plenty of room for everyone to spread their nets. I remember as a young boy, they used to have opening day to fishing season. I loved opening day. And Dad would take us down to the creek at daylight. I don't think you could cast your line into the water until 12 o'clock, but we were there at daylight. And cars would be lined up out of sight, as far as you could see. And when we finally got to the fishing hole that we had talked about the night before, people would be shoulder to shoulder fighting over the spot. It was fun, but at the same time, there wasn't room for everyone. But that's not the case here on the banks of the river of life. There's room for everyone who wants to experience it. Room for all. And we're told in verse 10 that in the river of life there will be all kinds of fish, and the fish shall be very many. And if you're a fisherman this morning, there's nothing you want to hear more than that. There's nothing that brings greater joy than an endless supply of fish that will bite. I mean, that's what you're looking for. There's a joy that comes with fishing, isn't there? There's a joy to it. Seems like when you're fishing, the troubles of the world just pass away. Just pass away. There's a joy to that shimmer and sparkle on the water. There's a joy to the sound of those waters rushing over the rocks. There's a joy in being out in God's creation. There's a joy to it. There's even a greater joy when the fish are many and they're biting. There's just something about it. It's going to be great joy by the river of life. The psalmist describes it like this in Psalms 46, verse 4. He says, "There is a river. The streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High." Isaiah says in Isaiah 12, verse 3, "On that day with joy you will draw water out of the wells of salvation." The river of life brings joy. It brings joy to every living creature that comes into contact with it. And finally this morning, notice that the river produces abundance and healing. We're told in verse 12, "By the river, on its banks, on the one side and on the other, grows all kinds of trees for food. Their leaves will not wither, and their fruit will not fail. They will bear every sort of fruit every month, because the waters flow from the sanctuary, the waters flow from the throne of God, and their fruit will be for food, and their leaves for healing." Notice the abundance of fruit that the river of life produces. The banks of the river are lined with all types of trees, and they all bear fruit. You can eat everywhere you go. That's paradise, isn't it? Everywhere you go. And we're told here that the trees just keep producing fruit month after month after month after month for all of eternity. It never stops. Never stops. And we're told here that the leaves of the trees are for healing. They're therapeutic to us. Somehow these leaves enrich our lives in eternity. They make eternal life full and satisfying. And we're told the exact same thing in Revelation chapter 22, verse 2. There we're told, "In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healings of the nations." The healing of God's people. And we get a glimpse of that healing, I think, in the book of Isaiah. And this healing is complete, church. It's complete. Listen to what we're told in Isaiah 35, beginning in verse 5. We're told, "In this millennial kingdom, the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a deer, and the tongue of the mute will sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out, and streams in the desert. And the parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water. In the habitation of dragons, where each lay, shall be grass with reeds and rushes. And a highway shall be there, and a roadway, and it shall be called the Way of Holiness. And the unclean shall not travel on it, but it shall be for those the wayfaring men, though fools shall not wander therein. The lion will not be there, nor any ravenous beast shall be thereupon. These shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and even sighing will flee away." Amen. Amen. This is the effect of the river of life. It's transforming. It's life-giving. It produces abundance and healing. and it brings unspeakable joy for all of eternity. So what's the price this morning? What's the price? What's it cost you today to one day experience all these blessings that we've looked at here this morning? What's the cost? Well, here's the kicker. It's absolutely free. Absolutely free. Jesus says in Revelation chapter 21, verse 6, it is done. Same words he said on the cross. It is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. Jesus says this morning, I'm offering all of this to you without cost. It's absolutely free. He says, all you have to do is come to me. All you have to do is come to me. So I guess the question today is, are you thirsty enough to come to Jesus? That's the question today. Are you thirsty enough to turn from your sin and your sinful lifestyle and come to Jesus? Are you thirsty enough to put your faith in him? Or are you going to keep drinking this salty water that the world keeps serving you? Comes with great promises. But have you noticed yet that after each drink, you still left thirsty? Still left thirsty. Jesus says in John chapter 7, beginning in verse 37, if any man thirst, let him come to me and drink. He that believes on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. There is an incredible day coming for all of those who have put their faith in Jesus Christ. We're told in Joel chapter 3, verse 18, and it shall come to pass in that day that the mountains shall drop down new wine, and the hills shall flow with milk, and all the rivers of Judah shall flow with waters, and a fountain shall come forth out of the house of God and shall flow into the valley of Shittim. We're told in Zechariah chapter 13, verse 1, in that day there shall be a fountain opened in the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and uncleanliness. Again, we're told in Zechariah chapter 14, beginning in verse 8, and it shall be in that day that living water shall flow out of Jerusalem, half of them down to the former sea, half of them down towards the hinder sea. In summer and in winter shall it be. And the Lord shall be king over all the earth. In that day there shall be one Lord and his name one. That day is coming. That day is coming. But whether or not you enjoy that day is contingent upon what you do with Jesus Christ on this day. On this day, Jesus says, come to me. Come to me. Let anyone who has heard these words come. Let those who are tired and thirsty come. Come this morning if you want a taste of the living waters. Father God, we come to you today. And Lord, we just pray that you have the room. We pray that you've had the room. Lord, as we've looked at this river of life that'll flow from Jerusalem when you set up your throne in the millennial kingdom. And Father God, this morning we believe it. We believe it to be a literal river that'll heal the land. Lord, that's what we're anticipating. That's what we believe here this morning. And Father God, we want everyone under the sound of our voice to swim in the river of life for all of eternity, Lord. And I pray that we've seen this morning, it's more than just sitting on harps and stringing them. Lord, there's going to be a great joy. There's going to be things to do. We can walk down the river of life. We can see things, touch things, experience things. And Lord, this is what you want for all, for everyone. And Lord, it's free for the taking this morning to anyone who will humble themselves and come to you. Father God, I know for years I kept drinking the salty waters of the world. Lord, looking for something to satisfy that craving that I desired. And Lord, we know there's others under the sound of our voice who are seeking something. They don't know what it is. Lord, this morning I pray that they see that it's you. You're the only one that can quench our thirst, that can satisfy us down to our souls. Father God, we thank you for the great promises we hold in our hands and for this day that's coming for everyone who's put their faith in you. Lord, we thank you and we praise you this morning. And it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. This morning I'm going to ask that we stand. I think the invitation has been sufficient. If God is speaking to you this morning, why don't you come? Why don't you come this morning and join these four that we have today that are going to be baptized? If you're here this morning and you're thirsty, come to Jesus.
That stream preached about a while ago, where sin runs deep, His grace is more.
Where sin runs deep, Your grace is more.
Grace is found.
Where grace is found is where You are. And where You are, Lord, I am free. Holy. Temptation comes my way,
and when I cannot stand, I fall on you.
Jesus, you're my hope and
strength. You are mine.
Every hour. Oh God, how I need you.
Amen. Amen. Oh, how we need him this morning. Amen, church. Amen. Well, this morning it is my privilege to announce that Dolores Clark is coming forward here this morning, wanting to move her membership here to Hope Community. Dolores and I have got to know one another over the last few months and share a lot in common. Her husband was a pastor for many years, and up towards Galax, and he's went home to be with the Lord. And like I told her this morning, he's on the banks of the river, and she'll one day join him. But she is in agreement with our constitution and bylaws. She understands where we stand in the faith. And this morning we welcome her with open arms here in our fellowship. Amen. I'm going to let you go on back, okay? You can be seated for just a moment. I've got a couple of announcements and things we would like to go over here this morning. First off, if you're a new visitor here today, thank you for joining us. We pray that you've just had a great experience. The prayer that we always pray is that on any given Sunday, you would experience the living God. And we pray that that's what you've experienced here this morning. We would like to get a gift bag in your hands here today. So if you can hang out for just a few moments, maybe come and introduce yourself. I would love to put one of those in your hands here this morning. The biggest thing we've got on the calendar is happening today at 2 o'clock, and that's the baptism. Most of you know where that is going to be taking place at. If you don't see me before you leave here today, I'll be here to church about 15 till 2. If anybody wants to follow me down past the state line, you'll turn at Dollar General, go to the bottom of the hill to the church, and there'll be a creek there. That's where we'll be holding the baptism. We pray that every heart has been satisfied. That is the first step of obedience that God is looking for after you've put your faith in his beloved son. So we're excited about the individuals who've made that decision and ready to commit publicly their faith in Jesus Christ. Remember the cruise in. It's coming this Saturday from 10 o'clock to 4 o'clock here at the church. All proceeds that are raised is going to our youth and children's ministries. I've got a note here that says many that are coming out on Saturday are going to be dressing in 50s attire. So if that's something you want to do, come dressed maybe the way you was when you was a teenager here this morning. So just remember that. Hopefully the rain will hold, but if it does wash rain, we'll probably end up canceling. But as of right now, everything looks good as far as the weather. If you can help or are planning to help, we ask that you be here around 8 o'clock here on Saturday morning. And for more information, please see Patricia before you leave here today. Also here in a couple of weeks on Tuesday, June 15th, we're going to be having a WANA team meeting. I'm trying to talk too fast today. Here to church at 7 o'clock. This is for our youth and children's ministries this fall. For more information, see Travis or see Angie before you leave here this morning. We're needing help of all types, not only teachers, but we need people to assist those teachers. We need somebody in charge of games, someone in charge of crafts, someone helping with food, cleaning up. It's going to take a lot of us to come together to offer this for our children, but our children are worthy of the investment, and that is what we intend to do, to invest heavily in the lives of our children here to church. The prayer list continues to stay very long. And as you can see, we're missing a number of families here this morning. Many are on vacation today, so be praying for safe travels for them. Also, there's a couple of calls I received yesterday. First, we would like to add Dawn Quessenberry. This is Sarah Quessenberry's mother. She was in an ATV accident, and she is in serious condition down at Baptist Hospital in ICU. So remember Sarah, Tyler, Macy, the family, as they're down there here this morning. Also, we would like to add Gene Ross. This is Cindy McMillan's father. Cindy and Kenny are up in West Virginia. He has got pneumonia and has been hospitalized there. They're not sure exactly what's going on, but is, again, in pretty serious shape there in West Virginia. So remember him, Gene Ross. Also, I would like for us to remember Jerry Marshall this week. Jerry is going for some tests, a biopsy, so just be in prayer for him as he travels back and forth to Winston. And also, we would ask that you remember Vassie's wife, Linda. I think she's having some heart issues and is scheduled scheduled for some tests here in the upcoming weeks. So just remember Vassie and Linda in your prayers here this morning. Are there any others that need to be added here today? Any others? Tammy? Okay. Any others? We'd also like to add Anita Enoch. This is a friend of Patricia with multiple health issues going on. Anita Enoch, E-N-O-C-H. Anyone else this morning? All right. Well, pray with me if you would, church. Father God, we come to you today, Lord, and Lord, we come in here almost too excited over worship and the message that you've laid on our hearts, Lord, and I just pray that we've gotten a glimpse of heaven here this morning, Lord, a glimpse of your millennial kingdom and what will be taking place there. And Lord, healing for the nations, and Lord, that is what we need. Lord, that is what we're seeking, Lord, in our day and time. And Father God, I just pray that we would just keep our eyes on the prize as we continue to try to fight the good fight here on earth during this day in which we live. Father God, we just pray that you'll be glorified through everything that we do, everything that we say, the lives that we live, the choices that we make. Father God, I just pray for the protection of the people under the sound of my voice, every family that is represented here this morning. Lord, I pray for their physical protection, their emotional protection, their spiritual protection, Lord, in this world we live. And Father God, I just pray that you would just bless them, Lord, for their efforts, Lord, for making you a priority here today, coming out and worshiping you. And Lord, we pray that they leave here, Lord, having experienced none other than you, Lord. We just ask these things in Christ's name, and God's people said, amen.
Sing a little louder.